Japan's attack on Manchuria in 1931 brought about a watershed in the history of Japan's domestic and foreign policy. As far as domestic policy was concerned, there was an end of parliamentary rule in Imperial Japan. As far as foreign policy was concerned, Japan adopted a militant, aggressive foreign policy. From 1935 onwards, Japan wanted to attack China once again. In fact, the military leaders of Manchuria planned an attack on China because some important trading interests of the Japanese traders had been involved in China. According to Eichkar, a clever maneuver designed to put illicit profits into the pockets of the Japanese traders and to sap the resources of the prestige of the Chinese administration, unquote. Relationship between China and Japan began to deteriorate like anything. Throughout 1936, a large number of Japanese military leaders had been murdered by the Chinese. At that time, Japan wanted to close her ties with the fascist powers in Europe, particularly with fascist Italy and Nazi Germany. In 1936, that is in November 1936, the Anti-Comintern Pact had been signed between Japan and Germany. Just after 1 year, that is in November 1937, Italy also joined the pact. In July 1937, there was a minor clash between the Japanese and Chinese troops near the Marco Polo Bridge. The Japanese soldiers took the advantage of the incident and used it as a pretext to attack on China. And Japan immediately started an undeclared war on China. And the second Sino-Japanese war had broken out in July 1937. China gave a heroic fight. In fact, two important political parties of China, the Nationalist Kuomintang Party and the Chinese Communist Party, temporarily kept the mutual hostility in abeyance and decided to give a united resistance to the Japanese aggression. But despite this united resistance, they could not check Japanese aggression. Japan's success was outstanding, and by the end of 1937, Japan had occupied Nanking, then the capital of China. The Chinese Kuomintang leader, Chiang Kai-shek, immediately shifted the capital from Nanking to Hankou, and again the fight continued. But at that time, the Japanese Prime Minister, Prince Konoe, wanted to put an end to the war. They offered a peace negotiation to China, but it was not possible for Chiang Kai-shek to accept that peace proposal because he refused to yield to any humiliating terms and conditions, because at that time he was under tremendous pressure from the Chinese communists. Still, Konoe wanted to put an end to the war, but the military leaders of Manchuria did not want it. They wanted a relentless war with China. Konoe ultimately dropped his aggressive and militant war minister Sugiyama, and Sugiyama was replaced by a more moderate person, Itagaki. Despite this, the course of the war continued, and by the end of 1937, even Hankou, Canton and other places fell to Japanese occupation. In the end of 1938, there was a problem. Japan was confronted with some serious problems. The first major problem came from China. The Japanese leaders wanted to take off their hands from China, but in fact, they were not ready to give up the concessions they had been so long enjoying in China. The second problem was that throughout 1938, Japan was involved in a conflict between Russia and Japan broke out over Outer Mongolia and Sakhalin and Manchurian border. Eminent and outstanding Russian military leader Marshal Zhukov led the Soviet army, and Japan was in a very tight corner. Moreover, Japan was very much apprehensive of the increasing naval strength of USA in the Pacific. The naval leaders of Japan felt that USA was the greatest threat to Japan's interest in the Pacific. And fourthly, the Japanese were very much allured at the natural resources in the Southeast Asia, particularly in the southern part of Asia and Southeast Asia, because that area was very much rich with mineral resources. So, at this crucial juncture of international relations, when Japan wanted that, Japan was left with the option, either Japan was to ally with Great Britain or Japan was to ally with the Nazi Germany. But most of the military leaders wanted that Japan should ally herself with the Nazi Germany. They did not like an alliance with Britain at that particular moment. But Nazi Germany refused to an anti-Soviet pact with Japan. They categorically declared that Japan should also take a clear anti-British and anti-US stand as well. But the Japanese Ministry of War and External Affairs Ministry rejected the German proposal. At this situation, a very important development suddenly occurred. On 23rd August 1939, the Russo-German Non-Aggression Pact had been signed between Hitler and Stalin. Japan felt that she had been betrayed by Germany, particularly the pro-German leaders of, pro-Nazi leaders of Japan, and the pro-German leaders of Japan got very much disillusioned. At the time, Japanese Prime Minister was Hironuma. He was a strong protagonist for an alliance with Germany. He had also to resign. At the time, Abe had replaced him as the new Prime Minister of Japan. After becoming the Prime Minister, Abe declared that Japan is going to maintain a policy of equidistance both with fascist Italy and Nazi Germany and also with Great Britain and France, that is the Allied powers. But by this time, the Second World War had begun. On 1st September 1939, Germany had invaded Poland. On 3rd September 1939, Great Britain declared war on Germany and the Second World War had broken out. Japan, in the initial stages, did not take any part. But by the middle of 1940, Japan was absolutely mesmerized by the outstanding success of the German forces in all the battlefields. Again, the pro-German elements in the Japanese government pressed for an alliance with Nazi Germany. At that time, some important developments and changes took place in the internal affairs of Japan as well. A very authoritative constitution had been introduced. The king's power had been strengthened and an imperial rule of assistance organization had also been formed to strengthen the monarchy. All the political parties were disbanded in Japan and Japan was ready to go to war. In this situation, in September 1940, the Tripartite Axis Pact took place and it was signed by fascist Italy, Nazi Germany and Japan. It was an important development in the history of the Second World War. So long, United States of America was only concerned with the developments in Europe. She had no interest in the Far East. But the Tripartite Axis Pact, when Japan joined the Tripartite Axis Pact, America was apprehensive of the developments in the Far East as well. In fact, in the wake of Japanese attack on China in 1937, there was a public opinion was growing against Japan. There was a tremendous and very bitter anti-Japanese public opinion in America. Now, the US government could not afford to ignore that public opinion. The public pressure was that America now take some steps to put an end to the Japanese aggression. In July 1940, the United States of America had snapped all the commercial ties with Japan. In September, America declared that America would put an economic embargo on Japan and stopped exporting steel, iron, all kinds of war materials and all sorts of petroleum products to Japan. Japan was in badly need of petroleum products. Japan realized that only way was to move towards the Southeast Asia, because the Southeast Asia, particularly the Dutch East Indies, and the entire area which had been the either British or French or the Dutch colonies were very rich in mineral oils. Japan realized that Japan must move southward and launch a southward expedition for having control of those mineral oil and petroleum products. But at the same time, the Japanese ministers and the military leaders, everybody knew that if Japan launched an attack on the Southeast Asia, particularly against Dutch East Indies, it would mean a conflict with America, and still Japan hesitated. In July 1941, however, Japan, defying all American threatenings and warnings, moved southward, and southern part of Indochina had been occupied by Japan. The response was quick and immediate. The Dutch colonies of East Asia and the British colonies of East Asia immediately stopped all kind of petroleum export to Japan. In no time, Japan saw that the import of her petroleum products had diminished by at least 10%. Japan realized that Japan must go to war. Still, a group of the Japanese politicians who still believed in civil governments and not the military leaders wanted to keep the path of negotiation open. They decided that they would send a proposal to the US government for a peace negotiation. Accordingly, the government of Japan sent a proposal to the US government. The proposal was that Japan was ready to withdraw her forces from Southeast Asia. But as far as China was concerned, United States of America should not intervene, and Japan did not want to withdraw her forces from China. Roosevelt, then the US president, was largely convinced, and a negotiation was going on still. But Cordell Hull, then the Secretary of State, was very much uncompromising. Cordell Hull, in fact, took a moral stand on Japan's aggression. To him, Japan was an aggressor state, so Japan should be stopped at any cost. He informed Roosevelt that, and convinced his president that any change, any shift in Japan's foreign policy would jeopardize Japan's relationship with China, Australia, Holland, and Britain. So the US must not compromise with Japan. Accordingly, Cordell Hull, the Secretary of State of America, sent a 10-point program to Japan. The 10-point program was very interesting. It was an unconditional demand. The 10-point program demanded that if Japan had to enter in a peace negotiation, before that Japan must withdraw her all the forces from China, from Manchuria, and also from Southeast Asia. But it was not possible to accept for Japan. The Japanese military leaders, including the Japanese politicians, everybody realized that Cordell Hull, through his 10-point program, has closed all avenues of negotiation with Japan in this regard. Still, Japan waited for some time, but Cordell Hull did not want to wait. Cordell Hull again informed the Japanese government, at first you withdraw your army from the three places, you vacate Manchuria, you vacate Southeast Asia, you vacate China, withdraw your forces, and then come to the table for negotiation. It was a clear-cut statement. In fact, extreme and immense confidence worked behind the stand taken by Cordell Hull. Cordell Hull was still confident that Japan would not be able to attack America. Japan would not have much courage to launch an invasion against America. And he was still more confident that even if Japan invaded America, America would be strong enough, would strongly resist Japan and resist all the imperialist designs of Japan. So from this confidence, Cordell Hull, U.S. Secretary of State, said that you are to stick to the 10-point program, you are to abide by the American demands and then come for negotiation. The Japanese leaders were very much dejected and disillusioned. They realized that they had no other alternative but to take the path of war. On 7 December 1941, Japan launched a large-scale air attack on Pearl Harbor, the naval base of USA.
You talked of the Anti-Comintern Pact that was signed in 1936 between Germany, Japan and Italy. Was it against the communist countries, against Russia? And if so, then why was Japan so much anti-Russia? Was it mainly because of political reasons that you talked about, or was it due to some ideological factors also, like maybe communism was raising its head in Japan? That's why.
The Anti-Comintern Pact was signed between Japan and Germany, not by Italy. 27th November 1936, it was signed between Japan and Germany. Italy joined it 1 year after, that is in November 1937. Two things are very important. At that time, Japan was involved in bitter territorial struggle with Russia over Japan's occupation over Sakhalin, Outer Mongolia, Manchurian borders, everything. And on the previous day, I told about Trans-Siberian railways and other things. Russia had her interests in Manchuria, Japan had her interest in Manchuria. Even after Bolshevik Revolution, the same problems continued, territorial problems and problems of territorial control of the entire area. It was a very fundamental reason that Japan could not tolerate Soviet Russia. But ideology was very important in this regard. The Japanese military leaders very well knew that the way they were moving, the way they were organizing their government, a civil government had been replacing by a military government. They wanted to replace the civil governance by military governance. It was against the principle of communism. They were quite aware of it. Moreover, in the early 1930s, when state repression began, the first onslaught of the Japanese military leaders came on the Japanese left. There were enormous left literatures, left study groups had been emerging in Japan. The Japanese Communist Party was becoming very strong, and in several industries, very developed large-scale industries, the trade union movement had been organized mainly by the communists. These army leaders who planned such aggressive foreign policy were very bitterly anti-communist as far as their ideology was concerned. They found in Hitler and Mussolini a very close ally as far as their ideology was concerned. But one thing was there. Japan, there is a debate that was Japan a fascist state? The answer is categorically no. In that sense, Japan was not a fascist state as there was due say. In Italy, Mussolini was all in Italy. Hitler was Führer in Germany. He was all in Germany. In Japan, there was no personal dictatorship in that sense. But in Japan, the main thing was that the army would rule. There would be a group of army oligarchy. They will determine the economy of Japan. They will help the Joibatsu, that is the industrial class. And the army would have a say. There was difference in their politics. But one thing was common, that everybody, Hitler, Mussolini, and the Japanese leaders like Tojo and others, everybody was bitterly anti-communist as far as ideology was concerned. So control over the territory was the primary cause, but no less important was the role of ideology also.
So how long did the Anti-Comintern Pact continue, till the Russo-German Non-Aggression Pact was signed?
In fact, when the Spanish Civil War broke out in Spain, on one side there were the democratic forces and on the other side General Franco, the military leader. Italy and Germany went on helping General Franco, the military dictator of Spain. Stalin said that nobody should interfere as it was an internal affair of Spain. In the internal affair of Spain, nobody should interfere. Great Britain and France agreed it on principle, but they did not prevent Hitler and Mussolini. The Spanish Civil War made the situation very worse, and the relationship between the fascist and the communist grew worse during the Spanish Civil War, and then Soviet Russia began to send army in favor of the democratic forces in Spain. In the Spanish Civil War, Japan had no role. It continued, but it was not very active. It was the time between May and August 1938, the war between Japan and Russia took an intense form over the territorial control in Manchuria, Mongolia, Outer Mongolia, and the. It was just after 1 year, that is in August 1939, when the Nazi-Soviet pact was, non-aggression pact was signed, Japan felt betrayed. And Japan thought that the anti-Comintern pact was over. Germany has become, Nazi Germany has become pro-communist, I have remained anti-communist. It is very interesting. But when there was early success of Germany, Japan again wanted a tie with Nazi Germany. There is another thing. At that time, Japan's main enemy was, at that time, USA was turned into the main enemy of Japan in the Pacific area. In 1941, Japan thought that USSR, that is the Soviet Russia, could be ignored. But USA cannot be ignored. But June 1941, Hitler invaded Soviet Union, violating all the terms and conditions of the Russo-German Non-Aggression Pact. When this occurred, Japan again felt betrayed that now I am becoming pro-Soviet, now Germany has invaded Soviet Russia. There was a dichotomy of the entire development throughout the Second World War as Japan's interest was concerned. Japan could not always merge her interest with the German and Italian interest. But Japan stayed with them. Because so far as political structure was concerned, Japan felt her more close to fascist Italian Nazi Germany than with democratic America, Britain or France, or absolutely with communist, socialist Soviet Russia.
In one of your earlier lectures, you had talked about England and Japan having a very cordial relationship, especially during the time when Japan was industrializing and England used to lend her support. So when the world was being divided, the European world was being divided into the Allied and the Axis forces. Why was it that England never tried to win Japan to her side, to the side of the Allied forces?
In my earlier lecture, I told about Washington Conference. And after Washington Conference, Japan's relationship with England was very bad, grew very worse. Because Britain supported United States of America in reducing Japan's naval power in the Pacific. From then on, their relationship began to deteriorate. After the Manchurian crisis, Great Britain did not want to take any step against Japan. Japan was happy with the British foreign policy, that Britain is not going to take any steps against me. But it was not possible for Britain to develop ties with Japan because there was a tremendous public pressure in Britain and America as well, which I have said that the majority of the British citizens did not like Japan's aggressive attitude against a weak country like China. They thought that Great Britain should take a stern action against Japan. Great Britain did not take any stern action before 1941. There was a policy of appeasement not only to fascist Italian Nazi Germany, there was a policy of appeasement to the Japan as well. But it was not possible for the British policymakers to go to a tie with Japan, ignoring and that public opinion within his own country. They had to face elections, the British government, American government. This is the question of political structure. So, Great Britain did not try to win over Japan. It was not possible. But Great Britain connived at the, encouraged the Japanese aggression tacitly in a very clever manner. And if you go through A.J.P. Taylor's book, The Origins of the Second World War, the policy of appeasement has been very brilliantly described, how Great Britain was encouraging tacitly, but did not take any open stand. In fact, Japan's involvement in the Second World War must be traced back from Japan's attack on Manchuria in 1931. In 1937, Japan again started an undeclared war on China, and the Second Sino-Japanese War had broken out. By this time, Japan was aggrieved with Germany when in 1939, Germany entered into the Nazi-Soviet Non-Aggression Pact with Soviet Russia, as by that time, Soviet Russia had been one of the greatest enemies of Japan. In the Pacific, Japan's rivalry with America was also very significant, and Japan was confronted with enormous problems in Pacific with America and in the Manchurian border with Russia. More important was that, for having her control in the Southeast Asia, the Dutch, British and French colonies, the area which was very rich in mineral resources and particularly mineral oils, Japan having control over the petroleum products there, Japan took an aggressive stand towards South, and expansion program had been taken by Japan towards the Southeast Asia. America was not ready to tolerate it, and America demanded that Japan should be stopped. America placed the 10-point program and gave an ultimatum to Japan that Japan should immediately withdraw her army from China, Manchuria, and Southeast Asia. Japan did not agree, and ultimately Japan retaliated by launching a severe bomb attack on Pearl Harbor, the US naval base. The Second World War entered into a new phase, and the Pacific War and Second World War became an integral part of each other.